Hey, Mark. Mark, what are we doing?
We're doing Elfette's Handoff.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, I'm gonna share my screen.
Great.
We're at nitrogen in.
Yeah, okay.
So let's go ahead and start over, though.
Okay, so let's start over. So from the top again, our test stand here looks like we have high pressure nitrogen on the left side. And basically the way to read this diagram is that it flows from the left side towards the right side. Inlets are most, it occurs on the left side. Gases and liquids flow through, and then the engine is on the right side. Okay, so on the left side, we have a nitrogen tank inlet. And then the next thing immediately is we have five pressure regulators. These diagrams, all labeled PRV, are pressure regulators. Maybe let's start with just the fuel system, and we can just talk through the fuel system.
JP, do you think you could like point at the specific things as
It might be a little hard to see if we're using the very tiny camera. I know in Zoom, when Zoom records, it keeps like if you're screen sharing and there's video, it kind of prioritizes the screen share or the screen sharing that's most of the screen. You have a very tiny little square for
Okay,
video.
so tell you what, why don't I talk through a couple of the components on the fuel system, and then I will kill the screen share and we'll switch over and we'll do some hand cam.
That's a good idea.
Let's do a quick thing though.
Yeah.
Let's go to single audio on my laptop.
Oh, you want to do all audio through your laptop? Okay.
I think that's going to be much better. There'll
Okay,
be less
yeah, that's
echo.
fine. Am I still audible?
Someone?
Yes.
Great.
Okay,
Okay,
great.
good.
Okay. So starting with the fuel system. Am I screen sharing? I am screen sharing. Okay, great. Okay, so our fuel system here is our top row. So starting with our fuel system, we have our nitrogen inlet again. We have just the manual valve on the tank. Circles indicate pressure sensors or other sensors. So we have just some pressure sensors. And then our top line here, we go through a pressure regulator. So that's going to drop our high pressure nitrogen. This is a typo. I think we actually need to go through and remove all of the pressure numbers because they are mostly wrong. But anyway, that is fine. So pressure regulator drops it from high pressure nitrogen at the cylinder to the pressure required for the fuel tank. After that, we have a pressure sensor as well as a pressure indicator. So that's a gauge. Then we have PVFO1, which is our pressure and control valve. So that is the valve that we turn on or off to control whether we want the gas pressure to flow to the tank or not. After that, we have a check valve, which is a one-way valve that's going to prevent backflow. And then we have our two safety devices. So the first one is our SOVFO1. That is our controllable vent valve. So when we don't want the tank to be pressurized, we can open that valve and it will depressurize the fuel tank. When it's time to fire or pressurize the system, we will close that valve and then it will allow the tank to be pressurized. The additional safety device we have is our PSV or our pressure safety valve, also called a pressure relief valve, and that is a passive safety device. So this one, it has a set pressure of 850 PSI. If the pressure exceeds that number, the valve will open and it will automatically vent the tank. That's not really something that's desirable. That is a backup feature so that the tank will never exceed its rated pressure. A couple more pressure sensors, and then we have our fuel tank. Let's see, does that feel like enough to look through? Should we finish the
Yeah.
fuel system or?
Go ahead and finish it. We'll take it all the
Okay.
way through.
All right, cool. So top of the fuel tank is where all the gas side comes into it. We then have our fuel tank, which will be full of isopropyl alcohol. And then underneath our fuel tank, we have just another manual valve, and this is our fuel inlet. We're going to need a small hand pump at some point in the future to just pump alcohol in from the bottom of the tank. Either that or someone to hold the bucket of alcohol over their head so it will flow into the tank via gravity.
Yeah, that's what we're going to do. Okay, there's no question about that.
Excellent. Okay, so the fluids, then the alcohol, the fuel flows out of the tank through a pressure and temperature sensor through this guy here, VTFO1, which is a specially calibrated orifice for metering of the fuel. Another pressure and temperature sensor. And then PVFO2 here is also called our run valve. So that's the main, that's the final valve before it before the fluid reaches the engine. Basically, this one's pretty simple. If it's closed, the engine's off. If it's on, if it's open, the engine's on. And so that's our fuel run valve. And then finally, the fluid will flow into the engine. That's probably pretty good.
Yeah, let's actually step through that.
Okay, cool. I'm going to stop the screen share and hopefully, can we do hand cam? Is that how we want to do this?
That's how we're going to do the hand cam.
Okay, cool.
All right.
Hopefully excellent. That will show up well on the recording.
Okay.
Let's see, nitrogen inlet.
Yep. So where does the nitrogen come from, Mark?
The nitrogen comes from a mystery magical source that we don't know yet. We're going to be renting K bottles, I think, is where it's going to need to come from.
So okay. So there will be a magical K bottle.
Or six.
That has a pressure regulator on top of it. And then we're going to plumb some kind of flexible hosing from it to where?
I'm actually not sure if it will have a pressure regulator integrated into it. It might just need a manifold and a connection.
Ah, okay. So then
that's 2200 PSI nitrogen.
Okay.
I think we should start with one and see how long that lasts.
Yeah.
My expectation is that one isn't going to be enough.
Okay.
We need at least two.
Yeah. Okay.
One for auxiliary.
Well, we can run the whole thing off of a single input though. That was the whole point.
Okay.
Okay. So that actually is yet to be plumbed.
That's fine.
What we have here is our distribution on the PNID. If y'all are following along at home, there is a block where there are a bunch of regulators connected. That is this block right here.
Okay, where does the nitrogen tank go into?
This with a plastic cap on it.
Yep, good.
There is a CGA 50 something fitting. I think that's required. So either this is going to be, probably what this is going to be is like a flexible hose, is my guess, is a high pressure flexible hose to a bank of nitrogen tanks. But yeah, so that's just a cap keeping it clean.
Okay. Do you remember what the maximum pressure that the nitrogen system can take is?
We've built everything for 2200 PSI. If it's great. A little more than that, it's probably fine.
Okay.
Well, the regulators are going to be the limiting factor, right?
No, the regulators don't burst until 5000 PSI.
Yeah.
Great. Okay. So we can actually go ahead and crack a 2200 PSI nitrogen bottle right into that.
Correct.
And
that's the goal.
Okay, great. Good. Love it.
That's the goal.
And that's why those pressure lines are so big. Right?
Yes. They're big also because the quantity of gas required is stupidly large.
Great. Okay, good.
Yeah. So that's why the gas line. So we labeled everything. So fuel line is this one here.
Okay.
So the gas is going to flow from our block manifold up into our PRVFO1, if you're following along on your PNID. So that is our fuel pressure regulator. The nice little gauges screw directly into the regulator. I guarantee all of the gauges are going to leak.
They're only perfectly tight and they face the wrong direction.
Okay.
Yeah, that's a bag of joy that we're leaving to someone else to figure out.
Okay.
Why they make gauges where you can't screw them in and then adjust the face? I don't know.
Yep. Okay.
But anyway, okay, pressure regulator. If you're wondering why everything is so compact, it's because this is a very compact shape for a test stand. But so pressure regulator, high pressure, low pressure, the pressure is set by adjusting the knob. Okay, then we flow out and we actually do a loop-de-loop.
It might be worth coming to the back of the
I think we need to come to the back of the test stand now. So pressure sensor.
If you want to come all the way around here.
So this is the regulator we were just looking at.
Mm-hmm. Yep, right here. After this, the gas is going to flow into our, this is our PVF01. That is our pressure and control valve. So this is the valve that stands between the tank of gas and the fuel tank. So again, when this is open, the fuel tank can be pressurized. When it's closed, the fuel tank is not getting pressure. So anyway, the gas flows out. This hexagonal guy right here is a check valve. So that's our one-way valve. I'm 99%.
Hold on, one second, sorry. Okay, yeah. So I'm just tracing that. So that goes into the valve. That the actual gas goes in on the bottom down there. I'm trying to get it.
Sorry.
We came along here, mm-hmm. and then we ran back along past this pressure sensor. Mm-hmm. Into this valve.
Mm-hmm. I realize what you pointed out is actually a good point, which I don't even notice anymore because I've looked at them a lot.
Yeah.
The actual fluid control part is the stainless steel guy on the bottom. Mm-hmm. The all the yellow and black stuff on top is just the mechanics that rotate the valve.
Okay.
That's the actuator.
Okay.
So the actual valve is the stainless steel ball valve on the bottom here.
Okay, good.
So that's what's actually doing the gas control.
Awesome. Okay. And so now the some number of PSI, 500 PSI, nitrogen, whatever it is, comes up here, goes through the check valve right there.
Yep.
And then into what looks like the tank?
Correct. So then it goes into the fuel tank.
Okay. And that's the fuel tank over here. And the fuel tank has a bottom?
Yep, it does. Yeah. So
let's
take a look at the top first. So we're now at the fuel tank. Mm-hmm.
Did that one freeze?
Yeah,
it did freeze.
It's okay.
Let me just turn it off.
What?
It's fine.
Looks fine for the handheld camera.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that, actually. Okay, so there's the fuel tank down there. So that's our nitrogen input on the back. So right there, sorry. And then on the back side, after that, four port, there is something that goes.
So we have a T that loops back right to here,
okay,
which is the SOBFO1, which is the fuel vent valve.
Ah, good. And that's usually open, right? So that
correct. Always... This is a normally open valve.
Which is why it's capped so that we don't get anything in there.
Gotcha. Okay.
Also because I forgot. Did we bend that tube? I feel like we did.
We definitely did.
Okay. I don't remember where it is. There's a tube floating around that goes in there. But why did we take it off?
To move it
so we could fit it through.
Probably. Okay. Anyway, this just has a tube that goes out, so okay. It doesn't dump anything onto the electronics box.
Okay.
Good. Okay. Then our brass valve here is our PSV. That's our pressure safety valve. Well, I mean, the common name is pressure relief valve, but we already call it regulators PRVs. So this is PSV.
Okay.
This is the OCRAP valve.
Yep.
This one shouldn't go off during normal operation.
And if it does, we'll hear it and we'll panic.
Yeah, and you'll see gas shooting out the top.
Oh, just out there. Okay,
good. We can put away when we're moving.
Well, I would recommend tightening them, but
before we
loose for now, just for moving stuff around.
And if that cracks, we're just going to get nitrogen out of there. We're not going to get fuel, right?
I would expect you just get nitrogen out of it.
Okay. So there's
something's gone pretty wrong. So yep. I would, whatever you're doing, if anything other than the LOX fill PSV opens,
yep.
I would abort whatever you're doing and figure out what went wrong.
You bet. But that's just, for example, that doesn't have to necessarily come all the way out here.
No. We just wanted the oxygen and the fuel to get potentially dumped in different directions so they wouldn't mix.
Awesome.
Okay.
Why?
I think we finished the top.
We have.
Fingers crossed none of these fittings leak because they'd be a huge pain in the ass if they do.
Yep.
I'm sorry. Next time I would build it with fewer pipe tap and more flared or other tube fittings. Anyway, moving on.
Okay.
Moving on to the bottom. Mm-hmm. So bottom of the fuel tank, we have another T fitting. One side of the T is our fuel fill.
If you're wondering, is it supposed to be crooked? The answer is no, we just measured it wrong. Anyway, here's a manual valve. So the fuel fill will get connected on the other side of that manual valve, and then you'll be able to open it and just pump fuel directly into the tank.
So it's actually literally possible for us to put a IPA bottle on top of a short ladder and fill it.
Yes, you could literally do that too, if that's the easiest way to fill the tank.
Yep.
The larger line coming out the bottom is the run line. That's the line that goes towards the engine.
Mm-hmm.
It comes down and loops around. So some of the wiring is still in progress. Mm-hmm. And I actually moved some of it. I taped a little bit of it up thinking we were going to try to move the test stand. But okay, so then it comes down into this guy, which is the Venturi.
Mm-hmm. Well,
technically this is the Venturi, but that's the Venturi tube.
Oh, that whole tube is a Venturi.
This is all just an approach tube where you have sensor ports, but the actual orifice is just this.
No kidding.
Yeah.
That's so weird. Okay.
This is what you paid $800 for.
Okay. But we needed the approach tube, we needed the pressure sensors there, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, okay. If I was going to do it again, I might try and get away without the approach tube, but it's fine. We didn't know that until after we already put it all in place, so. Okay.
That's fine.
The thing here is the Venturi is calibrated for a specific flow rate at a given pressure.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason that, for one reason, if you notice the diameter of the tubing changes, that is because we already owned a set of these Venturis for about a 2 kilonewton engine.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to fire a larger engine, you're going to need to get new Venturis. And mm-hmm. I would just say, make sure you get 3/4 inch tubing.
Right.
And then replace all the 1/2 inch tubing in the fluid lines with 3/4.
Which luckily is just here to here.
Yep.
That's all that needs to be replaced.
So,
when it changes from 1/2 to 3/4, it's
go.
Just before and after the Venturi is all that needs to go.
Yeah,
so okay, it'll be a relatively small number of pieces that need to get swapped to run a larger engine on the stand.
Understood. Okay.
Okay. So then another pressure sensor loops back around, and our sort of cockeyed valve here is the fuel run valve.
Mm-hmm.
Where we stopped plumbing is at the other end, which is going to go into a three-way splitter and then into TBD piping to get to the actual engine.
Okay. And you say a three-way splitter because the engine will probably have three ports on it to
The engine has a different number of ports where it needs fuel applied, it'll need a different splitter. We purchased a three-way splitter, so we have one.
Okay, good.
It's just not here. So kind of what's going to need to happen over on this end is there's going to be a blast plate.
Mm-hmm.
So a hole will need to get drilled into the blast plate and then tubing will need to come out. We would recommend going flex line. It's going to be relatively low pressure. It's going to be in like the 300 to 500 PSI range, which you can definitely get flexible tubing that will do that.
Good.
If you notice right after the run valve, we haven't actually talked about this on the P&ID yet, but there is another fitting and another line. These are our purge lines.
So that's a good purge line goes through a check valve?
Correct.
And then up to?
Up to another pressure control valve.
Okay.
So effectively it's the same on the front end as the tank pressure.
Yep.
But instead of going into a tank like the first one did,
it
just runs straight down and just south of the run valve, which will allow us to basically, if you turn off, the fuel valve, the fuel run valve, you turn on the purge valve, and it will just blow gas out the engine.
Right. That makes sense.
Yep. That's going to be how we put out the fire.
Literally.
Yep.
Okay. As long as the fire is in the right place.
I'm a little confused. That comes out here, goes into here. Ah, so this is the purge pressure relief valve.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, so our we can talk through, we put labels on it.
Right, sorry. Yeah.
F, the way we numbered things was F means fuel.
Yep.
P is purge.
Okay.
L is liquid oxygen.
Okay.
LF is LOX fill.
Okay. Good.
There's one thing called M.
Oh, there we have a couple of sensors that we didn't know what to call them, so we called them miscellaneous.
Okay, good. Okay, good.
Why don't we talk through liquid oxygen?
Yeah. Let's go through the PID first.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So I'll switch back over to the computer. Mm-hmm. Okay. Am I still audible over here?
Yes, you are.
Okay, great. Oh, whatever. I'll just share the screen. Okay. So hopefully you can see this again. So we just talked through the fuel system, which is on the top here, and also briefly looked at the purge line, which is pretty simple. It's the same setup as the same pressure regulator and basically the same piping. It's the same kind of valve here. And then it's just a piece of tubing with one check valve that goes right in to the back of the engine. Okay, so the bottom line is the liquid oxygen line. The setup is very similar to the fuel system, with a couple of small differences. So we have the same high pressure. So when I say high pressure, this is in the range of 2,000, 2,200 PSI. Then you have our pressure regulator, which is going to drop it to something in the range of, say, 500 PSI. So that's kind of the order of magnitude. So we have our pressure regulator, a gauge, and a pressure sensor. Then we have PVLO1 here, which is the pressure control valve. So this again is determining whether or not gas pressure can get to the top of the liquid oxygen tank. One thing we've done for the liquid oxygen tank, just as an extra check, is we put two check valves in line, just to help make sure that components need to be rated specifically for contact with oxygen and liquid oxygen. Nothing upstream is. The check valves are, so we've just put two in a row to help just make sure that we don't get backflow. Okay, so then we have our two check valves, which allow flow only in one direction. Then we have our two pressure safety and pressure control devices. So we've got our PVLO2, which is our liquid oxygen vent valve. And we have PSVLO1, which is our pressure relief or pressure safety valve. This one is set at 650 PSI. And like I was saying earlier, you don't want it to open. That is a sort of something has gone wrong type valve. Okay, so at that point, the gas gets to the liquid oxygen tank. We have two temperature sensors intended for use on the liquid oxygen tank. The hope with these is that they could be used as basically fill level indicators. Whether or not that works out, I don't know. I feel like it might. We've been told by some folks in the industry that a totally valid way to fill your liquid oxygen tank is to continue to add liquid oxygen until it comes out the vent valve. I mean, if that happens, you know you're full. So yeah. If the temperature sensors work, awesome. Mm-hmm. If they don't work, just filling it until it comes out the top, I guess, is an option too.
Okay.
For a moment, let's ignore the purple section and just say that the liquid oxygen then comes out the bottom of the tank, goes through a pressure temperature sensor combo, through another similar venturi or orifice for metering the flow, another pressure temperature combo, and then we have our liquid oxygen run valve. The liquid oxygen line has exactly the same setup with regard to a purge line as well, where it has a check valve. There's basically a connection just after this line where there's a check valve and then a pressure control valve and then a pressure regulator. This was something that was actually suggested to us that was a more recent change. We previously were planning on running the purge lines off of a single regulator. It was pointed out to us that the pressure we want in the tank and the pressure that's going to be required to sort of maintain the same engine pressure as we blow the last whatever few ounces of fuel out the engine are not actually going to be the same. So the hope here is that by having an independent pressure regulator for each purge line,
you can sort of match what you expect the pressure at the back of the engine to be. So you get a sort of a cleaner end to your burn. Whether that works, I don't know. There's a couple of extra temperature sensors along the liquid oxygen line as well. The hope with that is that that will be used to help tell when we've chilled the line enough. I think I would recommend, if we haven't placed this one or if we haven't taped it up yet, would be as close to the back of the engine as possible. Just so that you can tell you've chilled the whole line.
Shouldn't we really ought to have one on the engine itself, or we just wait till we start to see liquid oxygen dribble out of the engine?
I don't know. It's a good question.
Okay.
Good question. I don't know.
All right.
Okay. Why don't we talk about the purple real quick, and then we'll look through.
Good.
So one of the other things that is still a fairly large unknown is that we don't really know exactly the best procedures and practices for filling liquid oxygen. So we designed a system here to allow liquid oxygen to be filled remotely. The way we've done that is with our liquid oxygen fill system. So basically liquid oxygen Dewar gets connected on this end. We have a filter. So that's just a filter to make sure the oxygen system is clean. We have a filter. We have a PSV. This is actually going to be a very low pressure PSV. This is going to be a 22 PSI PSV. And then we have a valve here, which is our liquid oxygen fill valve, LF01. The sort of very, very roughest outlines of how to fill the test stand would be connect the liquid oxygen Dewar, open the valve on the Dewar for liquid output, walk away from the test stand, turn it on, and then you can remotely open PVLF01 and allow liquid oxygen to flow into the tank. And then you can close LF01 and continue with firing.
Okay. So that means that you'd have to close the pressure vent on the Dewar, right?
Correct.
We're expecting the 22 PSI PSV to just be letting gas
out. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that's some of this is going to be, I don't know what's going to happen. We should try it with liquid nitrogen.
Yes.
Absolutely. So yeah, I recommend trying all of this with liquid nitrogen as well. As a yes, it's still cryogenic and can explode, but at least it's not flammable. sort of stand-in fluid.
Yep.
But yeah, kind of. I think the way this might work is yes, you're going to need to. My understanding is Dewars end up with two different valves, one for gas output and one for liquid output.
Mm-hmm.
And they also, I believe, have internal 22 psi pressure relief valves on them.
I think they were like 25 because we wanted to be just under, so we pop our PSV before the Dewars.
Whichever way it is.
And PSVs have like an infinite number of cycles, right?
Theoretically.
Apparently,
once they open, they may not open it precisely the same. Like you may get a little bit of fluctuation, like plus or minus 10% on the.
Okay, 10% seems okay.
Yeah, anyway. So what might happen depending on the amount of time between filling and firing or something else is it might cause the PSV here to open and just dump some extra pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And that's probably fine.
Good.
I think the other reason we did this is we currently have no idea how much liquid oxygen will be required to chill the components down.
Right.
So we have pretty small tanks. So one way, if it turns out it requires a ton of liquid oxygen to chill the system, then you could procedurally say, okay, well, we're gonna chill and use most of the oxygen in the tank, then we'll top off and then we'll fire, for example.
Okay,
why don't we look through the liquid oxygen system?
Yeah. All right, let me turn my camera back on then.
Okay.
Awesome. Okay. I'm giving everybody motion sickness.
Excellent.
All right, let's start from
Why don't we start pressure. from the manifold again.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So whichever one says LO1 is where we're ending up.
LO1. Okay, so another tube comes out of here. I really hope these don't leak because those will be a huge pain.
at least they're AN. Oh, one thing we should talk about real quick for leaks in AN fittings. We have a bunch of these seals that we haven't used yet, are just like little crush washers.
The pro tip. We bought a bunch of crush washers. Yeah, they're flare fitting crush washers.
Okay.
If you get a bunch of flared fittings that are leaking, you can use them. You can put them on the flared tip, okay, and they will help seal.
Flared fitting leaks are a lot easier to sort out than NPT fitting leaks.
Okay.
Hopefully NPT fittings won't leak so much, and it'll just be all the flared fittings that leak.
It'll be great.
So our pressure distribution manifold comes all the way up, runs across into our LO1 pressure regulator.
Mm-hmm.
Which then runs, we should probably flip around to the backside. Mm-hmm. So which then does the same sort of 180 insanity through a pressure sensor and then through our pressure control valve for the liquid oxygen tank.
So that's the top one up here?
Yep.
Okay.
So the tubing then runs out of the valve and up because the LOX tank is tall.
Yep.
So we have two check valves.
Yep.
Into basically the same sort of pipe, what do you call them? Manifold, that's not the right word, but cross any fittings, there we go. Cross fitting, and then T. So all the things that are connected here is this tall boy is the—
Okay, well, hold on for a second, going up for just a minute. That's the that's the pressure relief valve, pressure safety valve, excuse me.
It's the same idea.
Yep, up there. And then you also have a pressure sensor that's right there. That's
correct. Pressure sensor.
Okay.
Good.
Okay. And then we
Should we have put this one on a candy cane too? So small thing.
Yeah.
None of the pressure sensors are actually technically rated for— we looked at the materials. I think they're fine for oxygen contact.
Mm-hmm.
But they are none of them are rated for cryogenic liquids contact.
Mm-hmm.
So
that should have a candy cane.
We maybe, you know what? If we destroy it, then we can replace it. And just like, so for some of the other ones in the liquid oxygen line, what we've done is we've run just small sections of tubing to just sort of make sure there's enough space that there'll be gas instead of liquid.
So like curly cues.
I think we're on top. It'll probably be okay.
But if we're filling to the point where oxygen's coming out of the vent valve, we've got a half inch.
Okay, that's a good nuance here. Is let's say the top liquid, the top temperature sensor is at this level.
Yeah.
If you see the temperature drop and you stop filling, great. If that doesn't work and you end up needing to use the technique where you fill it all the way until it starts to come out the vent valve.
Yep.
In that case, then you're pretty close to potentially spilling. Potentially spilling. I guess you're also at the same level as the check valve, which maybe isn't ideal. Okay, if you can stop before you get there, that's maybe a better option.
Yep. Okay. Good.
In any case.
So let's go. Hold on. Come over here. Okay. So this guy.
Liquid oxygen vent.
And so it comes out there. Okay, and that's it. Yeah, there you go. There's the vent. That makes sense. Okay.
All of the cryogenic valves are super easy to identify because standard cryogenic valves have very tall stems on them, which they do to make sure that the top of the valve doesn't freeze, because this will turn into an ice ball, and then the goal is the top doesn't.
Yep. Okay. That makes sense. All right.
Yeah. It just makes it harder to get through doorways.
By a lot. Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Again, pressure safety valve.
Yep.
I recommend pointing this away and actually tightening the tube.
Mm-hmm.
We've just like taped bags over the ends. The oxygen system is all pretty clean.
Mm-hmm.
So I would keep bags on any open ends until you connect things to them. Okay, moving down underneath the tank. Same sort of system where we have another T. This guy goes off to the liquid oxygen fill system, which we'll talk about in a moment. Moving downwards instead, we come down through our— we've been calling it a shepherd's hook. Really, it was the only way we could get the tube to bend to do this. Down into our approach tube for the Venturi. Here you can see a crazy candy cane. It's not even as squiggly.
This is totally an experiment. If this doesn't work, I'm sorry.
Okay.
There's a tendency I've noticed with PSAS things to just sort of take things from prior years as gospel.
Yes.
I want to communicate that some of this is just totally throwing stuff against the wall and seeing if it works.
Yep, that's good.
We were advised that if you made a squiggle, you sort of make yourself a little evaporator.
Mm-hmm.
Whether or not we'll still get accurate pressure readings with our little squiggles,
mm-hmm.
I don't know. But the goal here was that there's going to be liquid running through the tube, and this guy isn't really rated for that. So hopefully it'll only see gas.
Gotcha.
Anyway, here's our Venturi. Here's our Venturi. Runs up through another one, which also has another squiggle on it. Oh, this guy needs to get tightened.
Yeah.
Why did we not do that?
I think that we wanted to bring it upright.
Okay, well, so this guy needs to get torqued. If you see fittings that have just a small thing, if you see fittings with Sharpie on them, those have been torqued.
Okay.
If you see fittings without Sharpie on them, they have not been torqued.
Okay, that's good to know. It's hard to see in the video, but there is green marks.
Yeah, right, we just use green Sharpie on everything.
Okay, good.
Any case, pressure sensor.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have our liquid oxygen run valve.
Mm-hmm. Okay, hold on. So that's this guy up here.
Yeah, so
okay,
what and needs then to happen? And so, yeah, so this is a very large valve.
Yeah.
So
that's the run valve. Keep going.
Yep, that's the run valve. After that, it needs to get from here into the hole.
we have bent the tube for.
Okay.
It's just not attached because there is a straight length after where it comes out that we don't know how long it needs to be until we mount it.
I think I can grab it. We have it somewhere.
It was washed last I saw.
Okay. Did I put it in the cabinet?
That would make sense.
I probably did.
Okay.
Nope. That's around.
Where did the
there it is, right in front of you, sir.
So this might be a bad idea.
Mm-hmm.
This might be a bad idea.
Mm-hmm.
Because you might actually have better luck with the soft tubing.
Mm-hmm.
But if hard tubing is the way to go here,
mm-hmm.
then we've built a thing. This is probably a terrible idea. Okay, well, that's not going to work. And now I'm not going to be able to get back out with the tube on.
Okay. I see. Okay, yeah. So that goes into the main, after the main valve.
Yeah, so we didn't know how long it needed to be, but
yeah,
this was our sort of crazy solution for how do you get the liquid oxygen valve to the center where it needed to be. So we bent this piece of tube.
Yeah, okay.
Which is also why PVFO2 is leaning off to the side so that this
fits. Oh, that's why that goes off to the side. Okay, I was wondering about that. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine.
I think the moral of the story is if you sort of duct tape together enough solutions, eventually you get a test stand.
Yep, that's right.
Yeah, so the other thing about the twisty was that so another reason why soft tubing might actually be a better option.
Mm-hmm.
Is that if you run a straight piece of tubing out of here, if you run hard tubing out of here into the back of the engine,
mm-hmm.
it's not clear to me when the engine produces thrust, whether the thrust plate will actually be absorbing that force
mm-hmm.
or whether the tubing will be absorbing the force.
Ah.
So it may be better to put a piece of soft tubing.
That makes sense.
For actual thrust measurements.
Mm-hmm.
We'd hoped that the 360 there, which mm-hmm. is definitely not best practice, would allow a little bit more spring in it, but it doesn't.
Yeah, okay.
It's very firm.
I think we're going to invest a lot in high pressure.
So maybe. You might still want the piece that goes up and then like maybe stops here.
Mm-hmm.
And then you just have like a 1 foot section of soft tubing, something yeah. like that.
Yep. Okay.
There's going to be some investigating needed for oxygen safe.
Good.
Lox fill. So lox fill is bent, but not actually washed.
Okay.
But that's okay. So rolling back to mm-hmm. the bottom of the liquid oxygen tank.
Mm-hmm.
This other piece of tubing comes down and across, mm-hmm. basically just to get us to a place that had enough space to shove another valve. Mm-hmm. So here's another extraordinarily large valve, mm-hmm. which is the liquid oxygen fill valve. Mm-hmm. What comes out of this one is I can grab the tubing we've bent. And there's a filter somewhere too.
I'm gonna find it.
Do we have it? We can just imagine a 6-inch long metal tube filter. Okay. Oh yeah, there we go. How do we do this? Oh, there's a T fitting somewhere as well.
Yeah.
We don't really need to mock it up, but.
All right, that's fine. So anyway, this comes out.
Yep.
There's going to be a T fitting here.
Mm-hmm. Which is where the PSV comes out. Yeah. Yep. Little
pressure safety valve.
Okay.
It's then going to go down. Mm-hmm. And this is the I'm sorry part.
Underneath.
Okay.
Yep. It's going to go down and back through. Mm-hmm. That's where the filter is. Mm-hmm. And then this comes out. I think the long side goes up.
Oh, it does.
Because basically we just played Tetris.
Yep, you did.
this is how we fill on the correct end.
Yep.
We fill from the back.
So okay. Now we actually haven't purchased, but we need another valve. We need just a small manual valve, I think.
Okay.
Or, yeah, probably a hand valve would be a good idea. Mm-hmm. And then this will be the liquid oxygen Dewar connection right about here.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
Yeah.
That's great, because then we can just connect it and in the back here where it's relatively safe and then run away.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. Good.
I think those are all the parts. So we haven't actually talked to actuator system. Why don't we do that?
Yep. So sorry, that was the entire liquid.
That was the liquid oxygen fill.
Yep.
It's
yep. Yeah, that's it. Okay, yeah. Good. So we've gone through all the liquid systems.
I think so, yeah. I'd be happy to consult on washing as well.
Yeah.
Ooh, yeah.
Okay, yeah, so that's all the liquid components. The last thing we haven't talked about, and actually we need to make one more P&ID update because we've changed this a little bit since we did the P&ID. Mm-hmm. Is, okay, so back to our nitrogen block distribution manifold.
Okay.
So we have this port. Oh, so there's a pressure sensor here as mm-hmm. well. That's just going to tell us what pressure the tank is.
Mm-hmm. Well, what? Yeah, you're right. That is the
yeah, because the tank will be right here. Yep, so okay. this is our high pressure sensor.
Okay.
Or you're asking what's going to fail next? This one is rated only up to measure 3,000 psi.
That's fine. Yeah, yeah. No, I'm not worried about
okay,
that.
So then we have a check valve. Mm-hmm. So this is where, so now coming out the side is where our actuator stuff is going. Mm-hmm. So we put a check valve in here. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about that in a second. And then the gas goes through this guy, which is also a pressure regulator.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. This is a very low flow pressure regulator. Mm-hmm. Hopefully it will be able to provide it. So we've tried this. This is the suction that we've actually tried now. Okay. And with the amount of pressure we were able to put on the high pressure side, it wasn't really supplying that much pressure to the actuators. Okay. But anyway, so you'll set the actuator pressure. The actuators all have a maximum pressure of 100 psi. Mm-hmm. So less than that would be good. Something in like the 60 to 80 range is probably
okay.
Right.
Good.
80 looks a lot nicer.
Yeah, as far it moves as faster.
Like the time it takes to open.
Okay. Yeah, so that, right, it doesn't. They don't care, but pressure does relate to opening speed.
That makes sense.
Okay, so then it comes up mm-hmm. in another game of Tetris, mm-hmm. and we have a large block manifold in here. So mm-hmm. we have a 10, I think it's a 10-headed mm-hmm. block manifold. We shoved a gauge in here because we discovered that the gauge port on this guy is not the low pressure side, which is stupid. In any case, we shoved a gauge in here, and then we have, on the other end, we have a pressure safety valve as mm-hmm, well. Mm-hmm. So this one, I believe, is 100 psi. There's nothing fancy on it. This is just going to protect the actuators mm-hmm. in case whatever reason they can't deal with full pressure. So pressure safety valve.
Okay.
Then we have soft tubing, mm-hmm. and so the way that all the rest of the valves rotate, which one's easily available? Here we go. Here's one. The way these valves rotate is there's actually a pneumatic cylinder, and there's just two different styles, the yellow and black ones and the blue ones. It's the same basic mechanism, just a different shape. It's a pneumatic air cylinder with a spring. Mm-hmm. So when the way you open the valve is you apply air to that cylinder and it rotates the valve and pushes against the spring. The way you close the valve is you vent the air pressure from the pneumatic cylinder and the spring pushes the valve closed. These are all, that's what's called a single acting actuator. Mm-hmm. So that means that all of these valves have a position that they will be in when they're unpowered.
So right now these guys are in the off position because they're the main, this is the main liquid oxygen.
Correct. Yeah. That's a good point. So yeah. So
you can actually see on the cap which position they're on.
Oh yeah, that's actually
so a good point. Have a white stripe, which is if it's in the direction of flow, then it's open. So this is the direction of the ball inside the valve.
Ah, okay. The hole in the ball.
The hole in the ball. Yes. Yeah. That's okay. That's actually.
And because this is.
So the valve goes this
that's
way.
Run valves. That's
yep.
So close.
Yep. So close. This is the direction of fluid flow. And right now the stripe is going perpendicular to that. So that means closed.
Right. Okay, good.
If you want to see, I can pick it up real high.
Oh, right. So you get my shaky hands because there's.
Can you see that, Felix?
Yep.
Yeah.
Cool. So that one is open because that is the vent valve.
Ah.
So that's why this is bagged and covered so nothing gets in.
Yeah.
This is permanently open.
That makes sense.
Until it's powered.
Okay. Yeah. Good. Okay. So let me take a quick look at one of these. So there are two little gold cones on top of those.
Yes.
What are those?
Those are mufflers.
Covers.
Basically, so what they're actually intended for is they're intended to reduce the volume of solenoid valves by just providing a baffle. They're intended for sound reduction.
Okay.
Right now, they were like $3 each. And so we're using them basically to keep bugs out of the holes.
That's good. Okay. And then the little angle right there is where the wires come out.
So yeah, so we got power. Mm-hmm. All of the valves are 24 volt. All of the pneumatic valves are 24 volt DC. Mm-hmm. So what you'll notice on all of them, in some flavor, there's a small box which has the soft tubing going into it, and then there's the large box.
Mm-hmm.
The small box is actually the electronic bit.
Mm-hmm.
It might be easier to see on. Well, we can
here keep
looking. Here. Okay, cool. So this is actually the solenoid valve.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the guy that you apply power to, and it controls the air supply to the actuator.
Yep.
Okay. What's inside of here is the pneumatic cylinder and the gearing.
Makes sense. Okay. And then on the yellow and black valve, it's exactly the same thing. There's the two
yellow. Yeah. Things. So if we're looking at like a yellow and black valve, like on top here, for example, or where are you at?
I'm up here.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So same thing. So different shape box, but also a solenoid valve here with the air supply and then the vents.
Mm-hmm.
Great. It's possible one of these is actually unused, but we bought enough mufflers to put on all the open holes.
Please do, yeah. Less open holes, better.
Yeah, and then this yellow and black thing is the pneumatic cylinder with the gearing as well.
Right.
Excellent. Yeah. Fun fact: if you ever want to convert one of these from closed when it's unpowered to open when it's unpowered, referred to as normally open or normally closed.
Mm-hmm.
You can actually unbolt the actuator and rotate it 90 degrees and rebolt it.
Oh, that's actually good to know.
Yeah, so they're all configurable.
Hey, so just a quick question about mounting these things. So the actuator in this liquid oxygen cryogenic valve, there must be a center shaft that we can't see inside that.
So this is actually part of it. So this is a little pinion gear. And there is a geared hole inside the actuator. You might have to come from the top.
So this does not spin, right?
This does not spin. No, there is a shaft going on.
There's
all
a
way
shaft
down.
There. Okay, that's what I wanted to see. But in here.
You know what? It's easier to see in the yellow ones.
Yeah.
So this little thing on top where like that small thin nut is, that's where the handle goes.
Mm-hmm.
If this was a man, these are all sold as manual valves as well.
Ah.
So that's where the handle attaches. So there's a little adapter here, which is like JP said, a shaft that goes up into the actuator.
Okay. And then these guys also have
these also have the sensors, the things on the top. So one thing that is still, I think, in development on the SAR side is all of the actuators have mounting holes on top of them.
Mm-hmm.
And oh, someone took the cap out. Okay, whatever. But yeah, so these little caps actually rotate.
Yep.
And it comes out.
There was a...
Is there a plastic screw somewhere?
Oh, no.
Okay, well, these all come out.
And that's where we put the Hall effect sensor.
That's where you're going to put the magnetic sensor, okay. Yeah.
Good.
For the position sensing.
And these guys are lightweight enough that they're completely supported by the tubing itself.
I hope so.
Okay.
The tubing hasn't gone anywhere so far.
They feel relatively sturdy so far.
We try not to put them too far away from a second support.
Yeah.
So if you look, there's only about like an inch or two on either side.
That's a good question. So the way they're all supported right now is they're just, the tubes are clamped on either end.
Okay.
I hope that's enough.
Yeah. Okay.
We've also were told that upside down, that like the documentation says any orientation is okay. Uh-huh. I hope that's fine too.
I bet it is.
For all the cryogenic valves though, we did add another tube clamp. It might be worth buying some that are the right size. We ran out, so okay. This is not the right size.
Okay.
Just throwing it out there.
Yep.
Oh, I figured out what we did with our other big one.
What do you mean? Yes. I think this one was more important though, because we didn't have anywhere to support the bottom.
No, that's good. Yep. Yeah.
That
makes sense.
That's sketchy.
That's totally not sketchy.
Okay, great. Well, then it's not sketchy.
Yeah, it's not sketchy.
It's perfect. Okay. All right. Wow. I think that's literally it. I had some stuff flagged for. I'm going to do one more thing while we're talking.
Yeah.
So all these wires, they're not color coded yet, but I think they're supposed to be at one point. Where so, we've got the red and black should be the valve power.
I think that's how it's working.
Okay, and then the yellow and blue and other colors are the two things.
Looks like there's some yellow and green and some yellow and blue for pressure sensors. Yep. This one's going to pressure sensor.
Yep.
There's a temperature sensor that has yellow and black, and then also green and white.
Okay. Yeah. So okay. Good. So all that comes various. It's not run yet.
So I don't know what exact state.
I do.
Oh, okay. For SAR.
We had it. Cool. We had it.
Okay. Great. Great.
So that all comes in, and then that comes into this box.
Yep. So that SAR electronics box.
Yep.
Which,
sorry,
in retrospect, is thicker than it probably should be for fitting through the doorway.
that's another problem.
Yeah.
And then inside there is the BeagleBone that talks Ethernet to the laptop that's 300 feet away, Marinette data acquisition device, some power over Ethernet to get there. And then these stack right there, that is the sensor interface and the valve interface. So that all those guys go up into that box and then go to the various boards. And there's no interface to them right now. You just literally just plug them in to the board directly. We thought that was a good idea because these ME guys keep changing all the stuff. So it's good. So and that will eventually need to be sealed. Okay. This is amazing. This is like as close as we've ever gotten.
Yeah. So,
okay.
I'd be happy to talk through some of the things that are left.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Okay. So, like immediately in terms of building the liquid oxygen fill lines, I think we didn't actually bend a. We never made a candy cane like a tall. We wanted to run the, so that's going to be here. Thought it was a good idea to probably run the pressure safety valve out the side as well, especially if that one's going to vent. So we were thinking we could run it like up and over or something like that and just have it run out the side as well.
Okay.
So that's a piece that needs to get bent. Other than that, the tubing for that needs to get washed and then installed.
Can you talk about the washing?
Yeah, totally.
Let's go through what's left first.
Yeah, so then the other things, the load cell, which used to be on the shelf.
It is on the SAR shelf.
Okay, great. And, you got another shelf in here.
Yeah.
Excellent.
We put all the SAR stuff here. It's way down there.
Okay, good. That's fine. The load cell wobbles a little bit. One of the blocks needs to get machined down, like maybe just a fraction of an inch.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Like, I don't know, maybe half a millimeter type thing.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't know. We just measured it wrong. but then that'll need to get mounted on the front and wired up. I think we bought all millivolt output load cells. So they're commercial, but I think they need to run through an amplifier.
Which we have.
Okay, great. So then in terms of tubing, the big things left to figure out are from the end of the run valve into mm-hmm. the back of the engine.
Mm-hmm.
We sort of semi-intentionally didn't do that because...
That's this guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
Because when we were doing it, we didn't really have an engine figured out. So we kind of left it.
That was good. Don't build stuff you don't know about.
Yeah. So let's see. I think another section of blast plate might need to get manufactured as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, let's talk about the blast plate for a second.
There's that's huge gap in between the blast plates when you hang them up.
Yeah, when we hung them, there's about a foot of missing set coverage.
Oh, really?
No matter how you orient them, you can kind of get coverage,
yep.
and then coverage.
Yeah.
But then there's kind of a section in the middle, and I don't know why.
Okay, I'll talk to Julio about that.
Julio has more diamond plate, or mm-hmm. we missed one, or no one ever put them on.
Mm-hmm.
Who knows? Yeah, I don't know.
Right. What are these guys for? Do you know?
These are where we hang them. What are those for?
Yeah, the U-shaped hangers are for the blast plate.
But I don't know. It's a good question.
Okay,
test mounted blast plates as well, and the amount these stick out uh-huh. is about fine.
Okay. I see. Sorry. So those guys were the old SAR system. There's four holes up there.
Oh.
That's where we were going to put SAR so that it doesn't stick out to the side. But then when the engine blows up, it also blows up SAR.
That's weird.
Yep. It was a bad idea.
Well, so, I mean, you're kind of limited. So our technique for basically mounting everything was to use these, which are called Unistrut,
is
the brand. Mm-hmm. I mean, these are not, but that's sort of the Kleenex.
Yep.
Is Unistrut. So we bolted them all on. The advantage to this system mm-hmm. of channels is that they're pretty flexible, and there's lots of components that you can buy that slot into them. So we kind of just mounted them all with U-bolts.
Mm-hmm.
So technically you can move any of them around or take them off.
Yeah.
Hopefully they'll stay in place. We tighten the crap out of the U-bolts.
Yep.
So we've definitely destroyed the U-bolts, but,
okay.
So other things.
Yep.
Other things. This guy, I think needs to get rebent.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe not even rebent, maybe just cut it off and flare the end, just so it doesn't stick out the side. I think sticking out here would be fine, or mm-hmm. here. That's actually a piece I haven't covered yet. So the one thing that we added, which I said I was going to mention, when we talked about the actuator system.
Mm-hmm.
So this was not part, these two components were not part of the P&ID originally.
Mm-hmm.
We identified while we were reviewing the test stand that when we get out to the field,
mm-hmm.
the thing we want to do first is, or one of the things we need to do early on, is pressurize just the actuators and make sure everything moves.
Yeah.
Basically make sure SAR works, right? So we can command all the valves to move and verify that they all in fact move.
Yep.
To do that, we needed a way to provide pressure to just the valves.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't necessarily want to require that only the valves have an independent pressure supply. That would have been maybe the simplest way to do it.
Okay.
Well, so what we did here is we put a check valve in, a one-way valve,
mm-hmm.
and then we put a second inlet. So this is we call it our auxiliary nitrogen inlet. And if this side is unpressurized,
uh-huh.
And you can apply pressure just to the auxiliary inlet, and ideally,
clever monkeys.
Yeah, I know. Ideally, the check valve doesn't allow pressure to flow back, and so it allows you to just pressurize up and pressurize the actuators.
Right. So
reality,
when we're using the air pump,
I've just been putting it there.
Yep. Okay.
We haven't done anything
to try and not run compressor air through the rest of the system.
Okay.
On the hypothesis that the compressor doesn't make cleanest air ever.
That's probably true. Yeah.
Okay. Now the reality of it is, in the list of things to probably replace, is I would replace the check valve.
Why?
It leaks.
we get small amounts of backflow through it.
Okay. Not a lot, but you get a tiny bit of backflow through it. I think the reason is we ordered all oxygen compatible check valves, which means they're 100% metal.
Yeah.
they don't have a rubber seal.
I think
if we replaced it with a check valve with a rubber seal, it would leak less.
Yes.
That's my hypothesis.
And that's not going to get cold, so it's okay.
No, it's not.
Okay.
Yep. Just good. One of the other things.
Good.
So yeah, this tubing moved so it doesn't stick out the side, just moving the hand valve.
Mm-hmm.
We should put standoffs on the wheels.
Maybe make the wheels a little taller, farther away from the bottom.
So that we've got more clearance out of all this crap.
Yeah.
We got what, 4 inches?
A little bit. It totally works.
Okay. Like the axle.
I will say it's getting pretty heavy.
Yes.
So it's definitely a little bit of a challenge to tip down.
It's dangerously heavy, unfortunately, but yes.
I agree. I don't know what the right solution to that is, except for I don't have a good option.
There's literally no good option. Many people. Carefully. Yeah. Yep, that's fine. So far, we've been able to do it with, I believe, like four people, and it's been fine. I think that's okay. Safe and okay. Yeah.
So like these valves will need to get tightened.
Yep.
Yeah. Before anything happens, we should just do a full walkthrough of just like identifying everything has Sharpie on it.
Yeah.
Right. Because that means it's been torqued and tightened.
Okay. I'd love to do. Do we have instructions for cleaning?
Yes, we do have a procedure. I'd be happy to talk through it as well.
Okay.
But yeah, I would also be. What?
Where's that located?
Oh, good question.
Why don't you share your screen?
Yeah. Okay.
By the way, are there any?
Are you still the microphone? Okay.
Yeah.
Are there any questions from folks on the line?
Hey, I have a question.
Yeah.
I saw some coils that I think were going to some pressure transducers. Could you maybe explain if those are like heat exchangers or and the purpose of them and placement?
I have no idea if this is a good idea or not. We bought pressure sensors that are not liquid oxygen. They're not intended for contact with liquid oxygen.
They're oxygen safe, but not liquid oxygen.
They're fine. They're going to be fine for contact with oxygen gas, but they're not rated for contact with cryogenic liquids. So we were told by an industry advisor that sometimes what you can do is if you add some coil of wire, you can basically make a little DIY evaporator and basically just build yourself a little bit of like a gas bubble.
So you guys did that there, and there wasn't there another place?
Yeah, also here.
Oh, yeah.
And we need to do one more.
We do? Oh, yeah, we do up top. Okay. Is it a good idea? I don't know. It's probably not.
Doing nothing.
Yeah, it is a better idea.
I think it was one of those things where
Yeah, this guy right here should have one.
I think we should put one on there.
Yeah.
We could even just put an L, just go up and just put it up here.
Sure.
Yeah, Kabir, I think... The answer is these pressure sensors were like $100 and the cryogenic ones were much more expensive. And so we thought, oh, whatever, let's try this. It's entirely possible this is a terrible idea and we will immediately destroy the pressure sensors. In which case,
All right, so let's show the Google Drive.
Okay,
Documentation.
Oh, you want me to remember where we put things?
No, not really.
Okay. Any other questions on the phone? Alrighty. Share screen. Okay, so we are in PSAS shared drive LFETs. Okay. Oh balls, where did we put the procedures? So the problem is I know where we put them in our capstone, but we just linked to them.
Searching that. It should show you the hierarchy once you get to it.
Yeah, I think you're right. I'm just wondering if I feel like where did we... Okay, so One place I might start is, that's probably not it. If you're looking for books, we hid some books here under technical resources and research materials. We have the Modern Design of Liquid Oxygen. So this is the Husel and Huang book. We also have Rocket Propulsion, and also Rocket Propulsion Elements. I have not read this one, but I love Levy. That's always exciting. I wrote our cleaner room procedures here. That's not what I'm actually looking for. This is a bad idea, but I think we produce these for a base 11 report. So I think they got put in a weird spot.
I like the one that says delete this document.
Yeah, those are the best.
Okay.
Hey.
Hannah.
Oh, that's a bad spot. Okay. Sorry about them. Yeah.
I'm trying to get just like some links in the.
Yeah.
And
it's an integration. Oh, LFET's integration. Okay. I guess that's not the worst, but that's still not great. Okay, PSASH shared drive, nope, sorry. Name, come on. Oh, LFETs, okay, great. So right now it's an LFETs integration test firing procedure. Why there are multiple ones, I'm not certain. Okay, but anyway, here we go. Preliminary procedure, site setup, test firing, liquid oxygen handling and storage. Pretty sure this is the one. Parts preparation for lock service. Works, clean your workstation, take apart pieces. Here are some things. We didn't have an ultrasonic cleaning machine. So basically the procedure that we used for liquid oxygen cleaning was to clean the area. And then we covered some of the surfaces in plastic. And so we did an initial soak. So we all the parts that could be submerged, we submerged in basically hot soapy water and let them sit for 10 or 15 minutes, at least 10 minutes. And then we scrubbed them with, we just scrubbed them with brushes. And then we rinsed under a lot of hot water. After that, we did use isopropyl alcohol and we didn't have an ultrasonic cleaning machine. So we did an isopropyl alcohol rinse, which in addition to hopefully getting any remaining contaminants out, also displaced all the water. It means they dry much quicker. So then we had basically a plastic area with a cover on it to try and reduce any sort of, any sort of dust or particulates. And so we let the components dry in the sort of cleanish dry area. And then after that, we did an inspection with both flashlight, white light, and also UV flashlight. If we found any sort of contamination or anything that looked even sort of vaguely suspicious, we just rejected them and threw them back in and washed them again. I think that was fairly good. Oh, and then we double bagged them all.
Awesome.
Yeah. And we wore masks, obviously, but then also gloves for handling of everything so we don't get any hand junk on them. Nitrile gloves. let's see, for some of the complex components, I'm trying to think which parts did we take apart. We disassembled the purge and liquid oxygen pressure valve. We did it, we actually disassembled the valves because we were concerned that they were greased with random weird grease, which in fact they were. So we disassembled them, washed them, and then greased them with oxygen compatible grease, and then we put them back. Hopefully that was audible.
Yeah.
Well, you say that, but you're not on the phone.
No, it sounded fine.
Okay, good. Okay, great. I'm glad to hear that. Okay, so yeah, in terms of where are other procedures located, this is in PSAS shared drive, LFETS integration. The reason it's there is because we wrote a lot of these procedures for a base 11 design review report. That's not a good reason, I'm sorry. I would honestly recommend probably pulling them out and putting them somewhere else, but that's where they are for now. One of the things that is 100% definitely going to need to get changed is the test firing procedure and the site setup procedure. When we made these documents, names of valves were different. The whole system looked a little bit different. So I would highly recommend going through and actually writing checklists with actual valve names as they're labeled now. Let me see if this loads. So whatever, let me just go to fuel filling. So we wrote a bunch of checklists, which I think is the right way to think about procedures, to just have physical checklists that we go through. However, some of the names might be the same. Some of the names might not be the same. So I would go through and read all the procedures and make sure that they still match components as they exist on the test stand. And yeah. Oh, you found the flashlight? the real story is those are exceedingly cheap on Amazon. So they're not hard to find. So procedures, I would strongly recommend going through, and the names might be right now. I know we went through and did some updates, but I would double check that they're correct. Moving back to the LFETS folder, some other sort of key things in the LFETS folder. So we talked, I think, briefly at the beginning about the PNID. So you can find that here. If you need to modify the PNID, unfortunately, I've just been looking by last modified date. But the draw.io version is the one that you can modify and then just export as PDF. This one for SAR is just a simplified one where all the labels have been stripped out, so it made a better GUI background. The other thing that's important in here, and I'm pretty sure it's up to date, is we have a bill of materials spreadsheet. So if you're curious about part numbers or anything like that, those should all be updated. I'm sure there's something that's not and is going to make me a liar, but for example, okay, well, so here's an example where I'd filtered it down to just the PTs, just the pressure sensors. And then you can see which system they're on, what their names are. If you find old documentation, we try to convert them from one system of names to another. And then you can find the model numbers as well. Theoretically, we have data sheets linked, but I can't guarantee we have 100% of the data sheets linked. Let me clear. Does that do it? Nope, that's not how you do it. Okay, select all. Okay, great. But whatever you're interested in, if you say, oh, what is this check valve? I want to buy another one. Oh, it's a Rego brand CG500 SS. and you know, you can find a link to the data sheet for it.
That's awesome.
There are definitely some holes in here, which I apologize for, but we've got most of the stuff here.
It wouldn't be a bill of materials if there weren't holes.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I think some of the temperature sensors may have been replaced, which I don't know about. But yeah, most of the stuff you'll be able to find the parts in here. It did occur to us, we didn't actually list any of the tube fittings. But if you need tube fittings, the place we purchase the vast majority of the fittings from is Titan Fittings or stainlesssteelfittings.com. We do, however, have a box full of lots of extra fittings because apparently I'm counting challenged and we ordered too many.
So all of the Titan brand fittings have the name engraved on them.
That's a good point.
They're laser etched into the fitting.
Okay, so looking at the LFETS drive, let me see if there's other areas I want to call out. SAR work is all located in the SAR folder, I believe, plus GitHub. And then we talked about Capstone Archive, which I think is particularly useful.
We want to make a mention to bracing.
Oh yeah, that's probably okay. So that's a
future work.
Did I put anything here? Nope. Okay. So a big area that is also left, in addition to sort of procedures and starting to pressure test and figuring out all of the logistics, is the, I wonder if I can find the, it's probably a bad idea.
Stopping from it falling over.
Yeah, I was just wondering if I had a place to find the, I'm not going to look for it. Okay, but anyway, the test stand needs to not fall over.
When it's firing.
Yeah, unfortunately, Rob was working on it, but he just got a job. So that is an area where there are some designs. Effectively, the sort of rough outline of the plan was make a big triangle that's assemblable in the field that can be staked into the ground to, and maybe additional weight added to the test stand to help keep it from flipping over. Oh, there's the ultrasonic cleaner. Totally hiding. Okay, anyway. Okay, if you need to wash more, sorry, if you need to wash more stuff, we just found an ultrasonic cleaner. Okay, great. You can, I guess, now fill with alcohol and do a solvent clean. Perfect. Okay, great. That's awesome. Okay.
I have one last thing to do.
Yeah.
I'd like to walk around with the camera.
Okay.
And you can just give us a quick tour of the shelf and the things in the cabinet, just so we know what the hell things are.
Okay, that sounds good. I'm going to stop screen share then. And yeah, okay. I can do a review of some of the, oh man.
So, yep. So those things are the eventual, what do you call the insulation?
Okay, for, sorry, I need to add a little more time to my perky.
Well, that's a good idea. Okay, so the insulation goes around all the liquid oxygen bits.
I think that's for the tank.
Just for the tank.
Possibly. This was kind of one of those Jennifer asked that said, hey, I have money I need to spend. What can you buy? And we said, I don't know, you want to buy some insulation? And then we got insulation. I think a these are for insulation. The, there's a lot of insulation. I think this was intended for the tank.
Okay.
I think for the lines, I don't remember, but maybe even just like sort of commercial tube insulation, like pipe insulation.
That kind of thing.
Might be better. Yeah, okay, the sort of like round stuff that's already round. Might be
$2 for like,
they're not bad, it's not very expensive.
And then starting from the top, there's some set tubes.
Sorry, this is extra feeding from when we made a meth lab. I mean, a clean room in a garage.
Yep.
If it, you want to use it, great. If not, it's fine if it's single use.
Yep.
Craft.
Do you know what that funny thing is? Yeah.
This? Oh boy. This is a custom fixture that was made to be able to take the aluminum 3D printed engine and mount it in a lathe for finishing.
Okay, good to know.
So
that's really LFE more than LFETS.
Yes, but it's also really maybe not
useful anymore.
Useful anymore. Nope, if fine. It is, cool. If not,
nope, know. It's going away. Okay, and then you got FlexLine.
What do we have here?
FlexLine.
So some of these are stuff that was inherited.
Okay.
Here's a bunch of pressure sensors, which are lovely pressure sensors, except they're all voltage output. They're all whatever 0 to 5 volt output instead of milliamp output. This is a box of goop. There we have two different types of Krytox goop. Mm-hmm. We have lubricant, which is used to go flare nuts.
Actually, we have a loose one.
Don't take it off.
That's fair. But underneath the nut is where you would put the lubricant.
Yeah. Okay. I could bring the fitting we destroyed down, but stainless on stainless tends to weld itself together.
Yeah.
So lube between the lube under the nut, just to keep it from galling.
That makes sense.
And then the other Krytox is thread sealant. Tube exploded. So
That's right, it's gunk.
Yeah, sorry. And then it's just some dry wipes.
And is that what I see there, or is that tape? No, that's definitely gunk.
The white goop that's all squirting out is all the tube sealant.
Okay.
And yeah, it's messy, but if it works, it's fine.
Yep. Okay.
The advantage of the goop is that you don't need to take it off.
Yeah.
To when you
reseal,
if you take the fittings out,
yeah,
you can just add more goop and put them back in.
That's great.
This was all inherited. So yeah, there's a bunch of flex tubing in here, which I haven't looked through in a long time, but like maybe if what you need to the back of the engine is literally just 8 inches of tubing.
Yep.
Here's 8 inches of tubing. Okay. Some of this was ordered from McMaster Car, who doesn't believe in data sheets.
Yep.
So
yeah, be careful.
I don't know what it is.
That's fine. Let's just kind of run through this stuff fast.
Okay. Yeah. So this is all inherited flex line from prior year purchases.
Okay.
These are extra components mostly for Unistrut. So just extra bolts, square nuts, little brackety type things. A bunch of extra tube clamps. Never the size you want, but lots of extra tube clamps.
Yep.
Those are all of the clamps that hold the tubing on.
Okay. Yep.
I think what we have in here is some extra mufflers, and then mostly what's in here are all of the extra collars and tube nuts.
Yep. Okay.
Collars and tube nuts.
Yep.
And then a few miscellaneous fittings, unfortunately.
That's fine.
I'm sorry. So probably
don't apologize for things that change.
Yeah.
And then you got some pipe. That's the
this main bag. Oh, this should go with the rest of the. Can you throw those in the bag with the brackets and things? So these guys are actually washed fittings.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the only ones that actually matter. Yes. Oh, here's the fuel vent. So these are all washed. And we got lazy with tape because I don't know. But yeah, so they're all washed and bagged. Here's also the liquid oxygen filter. Here's this guy.
Mm-hmm.
So everything in here with the bag on it has been washed.
Good.
We should probably put a little bit of tape on it so the bags don't come off.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just take things off. If you mounted these regulators behind a wall, these are little nuts that fit on the.
Yeah, a quick question about those. They're really easy to turn, so we should always think that they've gotten misturned, right?
Yeah. Well, okay. So they're going to be less easy to turn once you actually hit the.
Oh, gotcha. Okay, good.
What do you call it? The spring.
Yep. So they're just really loose right now.
Yeah, they're all at like,
so yes, definitely. I would assume they're all going to spin.
Yep.
There's probably. Oh, you know what? There's an Allen bolt in them. I bet if you tighten that, it locks the handle.
Okay.
That's my guess. Anyway.
Maybe that Allen bolt. Yeah.
I don't think so. Nope. I think this, I believe, is the self vent.
Okay.
These are self venting regulators where if you change the pressure, they will allow the overpressure to vent out.
Oh, that's nice. Okay, good.
This one does not vent it.
That one sucks.
Okay.
Some miscellaneous valves.
Yep.
This is the twin to this guy, but I think it's broken.
Okay.
It wasn't regulating.
Okay.
More flex tubing for actuators.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. We inherited all of this.
I think we'll go through and do a little bit of a junk collection and just get rid of it.
Yeah, I'd be happy to be here and help with junk collection.
Okay, good.
I don't know. We inherited all of this.
Doesn't care. Dump it. Don't care. Dump it.
Fluid. It's a what if it's a
flow meter?
Flow meter for a garden hose.
Yeah. Oh, that's good for our testing.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Some extra little bits of plastic.
Yep.
May need a little bit of mounting change on the fuel tank. These are all inherited valves.
Okay.
Some of them are. There's nothing wrong with them.
We just can't use them.
Well, I don't know. Yeah, so these are just miscellaneous extra valves.
Okay, go ahead.
This guy is a very lovely cryogenic solenoid valve. The pressure rating is only about 300 PSI. Here's a spare check valve, which we're used for like test fitting purposes. Nothing wrong with it, it's just dirty. These are all solenoids and random stuff that from prior years that don't work.
Yep.
I mean, function, but are not the right parts.
Correct.
Questionable gauges are self-explanatory. Seco seals are the ones that are probably gonna be really useful. Probably don't need the packing material.
We don't.
Let me pull the big ones. Not going to open them, but oh, they're kind of here. Oh, they're sealed. So basically, they're the shape of the flare.
Yep.
And so they're intended to get crushed between the tube and the flare in the case that they don't work. And I ordered them all as what the hell is this?
Quarter inch?
No. Maybe. It must be.
It says
15 in there. Maybe it's just blocked by the label. Yeah. It's probably just blocked by the label. Okay, anyway, they're all copper. They're all straight copper. Yep.
Good.
Which you can't burn, apparently. okay, moving down. This is a box. Oh, we shoved all of the documentation that came with the actuators.
Okay, we'll deal with that.
Sorry. We have a lot of, I don't know if the caps are occasionally useful. There's a lot of plastic caps.
Yep.
And more plastic caps, miscellaneous extra bags.
Fine.
They're not clean bags, but they're maybe useful. They seem potentially useful enough that we didn't immediately throw them away.
Right. Liquid fuel engine.
Yep. Old liquid fuel engine. Excellent desk piece.
Yep.
All
right, but yeah, let's just cruise through this. I don't think we need to do too much more.
Okay, some extra strut. This box is actually probably important.
Okay.
This one has a bunch of surplus, but all LOX clean fittings.
Oh, nice.
At some point, we decided it was dumb to try and figure out which fittings needed to go in the LOX system and which didn't, and we just washed everything.
It makes sense.
So there are many, many, many fittings, and they're all bagged, and they all say LOX clean.
Okay.
And as a general rule, anything that comes out of a bag that says LOX clean does not go back.
Yeah, if we didn't put it back into a LOX clean bag.
Yeah.
Which unfortunately is why we have another box that has some pieces that are sort of only sort of washed. Gotcha. But yeah, lots of extra fittings. If you need anything, look through here first.
Good.
Spare valves.
Okay.
Old shoulder bolts.
Okay.
Just... Oh, these are old parts from the load cell. This is a perfectly good, so we have two, one of the valuable extra things we have is we have two surplus cryogenic liquid oxygen compatible ball valves.
Okay.
It's exactly the same as that one.
Excellent.
They are just slightly smaller
in
terms of ball size. Okay. So if you ever need them for anything, we have them. Mm-hmm. The one that got open just needs to get recleaned.
Okay. We have lots of little things.
Most of these are from prior years.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So you guys don't really
think,
use that stuff.
I don't really think we opened. We might have opened like pipe and seal.
Yeah.
And then like this most. So most everything here should be labeled what it is, like miscellaneous brass crap, miscellaneous aluminum bits.
Awesome.
Okay. Yeah, so those I don't think we touched anything on the bottom.
Okay, and then can we go through the the closet? Oh, sorry. So
no, that's fine. I can't guarantee you. Oh,
we have a couple things here. Do you guys know what this is?
That's the box of miscellaneous stuff.
Box of miscellaneous crap.
Okay.
That came with us.
Excellent. Pipe bending, right?
Yeah. I don't know why I've never used anything out of this.
Okay.
If someone else has, that's cool.
Okay. Throw it down. We don't need it.
This guy. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Is the large, this is the large flare tool.
Ah, good.
We have a small flare tool as well.
Okay.
Which technically the thermal vacuum chamber folks purchased, but same idea.
Yep.
Mostly what's in here are tube benders, 3/4-inch tube bender. Hey, JP, did the half inch tube bender show up?
Half inch tube bender is at Emilio's
house. Oh, okay, cool. So half inch tube bender, there's a nicer one coming. Some very large wrenches.
Is that a torque wrench?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Okay, good friend. Yep. A couple of torque wrenches, some garbage tubing.
Okay. Yep.
Garbage tubing.
All right, so we'll go ahead and clean all that up eventually. All right, great. PSAs.
I have no idea what's in there.
Oh, yeah, no,
that's two wrench sets.
Okay. Yeah, just two wrench sets.
Okay, good.
This guy we did just purchase.
Yep.
Air compressor, new air hose. It's a really nice compressor.
Good.
By the way. Here is the small.
Oh.
Here's the small flaring tool.
Okay, good.
As well as a half a die set, which we purchased and haven't actually used.
Actually, one thing worth pointing out is in the wrenches, we have these two Crowfoot wrenches, which are the size of the AN nuts.
Ah.
So then you can torque wrench to exactly the right tightness.
That's perfect.
So these go in the torque wrench, and we bought all the adapters that you need.
I think we left one on the wrench.
It's fine. Okay.
That is really good. I've only put a few items in here, so most of this is going to be
old. Okay.
But let me see if there's anything in here that looks new. Okay. So we put, this is the tube for the BT0.
Okay.
These are raw stock for BT0.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, did the pieces for BT0 show up?
2 out of 3.
Okay. Where did the pintle go?
Right there.
Pintle
by your arm.
No, this is not.
Oh.
This old pintle.
Oh, okay.
Pintle.
2015 pintle. Why don't we put it with the other ones? Why don't we just put it down?
Okay.
So new pintle.
Yep.
It's on the box of John Hare.
John Hare.
That's fine. You don't need to open it. Good new pencils. Do you know what that plate is?
Nope.
Okay, that's fine.
No idea. Oh my God, no idea.
Okay, good. That's it then.
These are the plug gauges.
Oh, good.
Oh, yeah, plug gauges. Yep.
Nice.
Nope. Yep. No idea.
Okay, good.
And
then that's our
CS. If you want these for something else, yep, they're down here. By the way, you definitely didn't see, but there's a.
Oh, good.
Yep. Nope. It's not there.
Yep. Not there.
We're not storing liquid oxygen in the bottom of a random cabinet.
You mean BTA? But yes.
No, it's not. It's Map Pro and
oh, really?
SES oxygen.
Oh. Okay. Then we should move that out of the way.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Hasn't blown up yet. I think.
That's it.
I think that's all of it. Other miscellaneous items. This is precision bucket.
The high precision bucket. What's in the high precision bucket?
Well, nothing right now, but what it's really good for is the point at which you need to measure the flow rate of something.
Oh, it's a calibrated bucket.
No, it's not, but you can put it on a scale. Okay, I think that's it.
Okay, these tubes, where are your spare tubes?
Oh, yeah.
So we've got some Unistrut.
I don't know what this is. I don't actually know what's in here. There is tubing in here, but I don't think we bought this one.
Okay.
All
right.
Yeah, okay, so there's some extra tubing here. Mm-hmm. This is old tubing, which I think they bought a thinner wall tube.
Okay.
Three-quarter back here.
Is there a little bit of three-quarter? Okay.
Yeah, why don't you all put it together?
Yeah, okay, so we bought 3/8, which we didn't use. I don't know what happened to the rest of the quarter.
Okay.
But so 1/2-inch, 3/4, 3/8, which we didn't really buy fittings for. It was probably a mistake. A little bit of a quarter.
Yeah, there's short sections of everything here.
Yeah.
We'll get a box and put that all in the box.
Okay, yeah.
This is stuff that could be scrapped that could be used for something.
So I what I will do is I will schedule a cleanup day if you guys are okay with that.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'd be happy to come to a cleanup day and help.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right, you guys. Wow, that was a lot. That only took us 2 hours.
Sorry.
No, don't be sorry. That was awesome. Thank you.
Your average capstone. It's your average handoff. Takes a while.
Oh, say it louder, more loudly.
It's a handoff. It always takes a while.
Yeah. Holy crap. All right. I actually feel like I understood what you guys did.
Okay, cool. I'm glad to hear that.
Let's stop the recording. Thank you, everybody. And then we can talk smack after I stop the recording.
Okay, sounds good.
I think you started it, right?
Oh, yeah. Stop recording?
Yep.